Hey, what's good, people? This is Ian here, coming at you for a review of Ready Player One. I am fresh out of the theater, catching this one, and mind you, a lengthy film too. One of the longer films I've seen this year. It's clocking in a little over 2 hours, about 2 hours 20. I definitely didn't come into this film expecting a Lord of the Rings epic for that type of runtime. The book wasn't something that I had read either, but I do believe, without a doubt, that this film is absolutely loaded with discussion points ranging from pop culture to gaming culture to tech culture, beyond just the aesthetic that you see here. There's a lot of ground that's touched on that I didn't quite expect to be visited in the way that it did, but it was welcome. And I think Spielberg, honestly, gives us plenty to grapple with based off the runtime that we get. So at the end of the day, that really comes off as justified. Now, just a quick heads up for anyone out there that wants zero plot points revealed, zero spoilers, any of that. There are going to be some elements touched on in this review that go into a little bit of spoiler territory. So beware, you've been warned, look out for that. Otherwise, keep listening as we break this one down. So the year we are flung into, this is the year 2045, kicking off in Columbus, Ohio. Now you might think of Columbus for a few things, like the Blue Jackets hockey team, maybe the Columbus Orchestra. You can now come to know it for the stacks. That is the dystopian-style squalor of just extremely crowded housing that is basically literal to the name, just stacked on top of each other. At this point in the future, Columbus has expanded to a point, and it's just growing so fast that there really is not room for reasonable housing in the area where our main protagonist lives. We're following the story of Wade Watts. Now, Wade is played by Ty Sheridan. You might recognize him from X-Men Apocalypse. I think that's Cyclops. Now, one of the main aspects that just jumped out to me right at the start of all this is really the defeatist atmosphere you have everywhere here. This is down to the living conditions. It's down to everyone that Wade is surrounded by. There's just this sort of acceptance that the world couldn't figure out its problems, and people resort to escapes constantly. It's a power through the drudgery of each day in just this broken and still economically stratified world. It turns out the drug of choice to deal with all of this is called the Oasis. It's a virtual world that people immerse themselves in. I'm sure you've seen this all over the trailers if you've looked at any footage from this movie. There's no real attempt to try to blend the two worlds seamlessly or make things come across to the viewer as though there's a need to question which reality is the actual existence, a la Inception or a movie like that. No, there's none of that here. Wade himself loves the Oasis because this is his spot to just be and do whatever he enjoys. Now, this shapes up as something like a dot hack sign or Sword Art Online, but it quickly diverges from that. All of this and the Oasis is set against the backdrop of its creator, who has left an Easter egg in the world, the game world, that is, saying that the one who can find that will instantly inherit $500 billion and the sole ownership of the Oasis itself. Naturally, this sparks a huge hunt, not just for players, but corporations looking to get a piece of this and expand their own territory and their own influence. And that's in the form of the IOI Corporation, which, in my opinion, is really the vehicle base for a lot of the discussion you got, a lot of the commentary that this film is trying to deliver to us. Now, before we jump too far into the IOI and all that good stuff, I do want to point to the thing that likely people have seen as an attraction point for this movie. And I was saying this early on, it had a lot of Wreck-It Ralph vibes, and that is you're going to see everything here. This is like a gaming convention of film. Anything you can think of, from Street Fighter to Halo to Iron Giant to pop culture something, I'm sure you'll be able to find it, and you will probably have to pick through this with a fine-tooth comb or tweezers or something, just to name the number of references. In fact, it's a little overwhelming at times, and I think a legitimate complaint that I've heard about this one is that you have so many references given, but they don't really get their proper screen time. And it's not just the screen time, it's the lack of focus on these. And this is an interesting way to do visual language, because I really think this is part of the heart of the film that can be seen two ways. Now, first, it's amazing that with all the rights and everything that goes into different characters and ownership and IPs and everything today, that we're seeing this many cross-references all meet at one point. That isn't always done these days, and that's amazing in and of itself. In the same hand, I think there's something to be said for not having the same emotional impact for every reference you're going to see. I mean, Iron Giant is a good example. You know, this film completely lacks the type of impact or any of the emotional pull that you had in the original Iron Giant film. It's just there for, well, the sake of being there. Somebody thought it would be a great idea to have it in the Oasis, so here you are. But this is really a prime point, I think, play some devil's advocate with, to really look at and see what's being said here. I mean, my first thought was about how tech culture icons, how gaming culture icons get localized, decentralized, what all this stuff means to us. And honestly, how we seem to be able to disassociate gaming icons from their source material, I dare say, even more so than live-action movies. I mean, this is a movie where people have their avatars as anything from Overwatch characters to Street Fighter to Halo to... The list goes on and on and on. And instead of taking the opportunity to plug every one of these gaming references right back into its mother material, you just have the cameo and that's it. And I think some people are really going to hate that, but it's something that's pretty prevalent today. And I'd even go as far as to say that shows the power of the brand. A lot of the characters in these cameos are so carved out by now, they practically carry their stories with them. I mean, it's difficult to see Master Chief and not think back to the Hail Mary of Halo 1 and 2. It's, for me at least, hard to see Street Fighter without thinking of Chun-Li or Sonic Hurricane Supers or Flash Kicks or Vega Claws or whatever else you want to go into. It's just these references bear that much with them, and you sort of connect the dots. I think if you've been immersed any amount of time in gaming or the rest of the references that are here, and, you know, live action isn't completely spared. You're definitely going to see some Back to the Future, a little bit of some winks at Marty McFly and things like that. And Shining, The Shining 2 is really, really brought to the forefront here. Although that's mostly left alone as far as source material goes, but even still, it's bent and twisted in a way you might not expect out in the Oasis. All this comes into play early on with really just bonkers, just crazy race scene. This is another thing that's been previewed in a lot of the trailers, and about everything you can think of is happening, from King Kong going nuts to random wrecking balls in the street. It's a near impossible race to conquer until Wade really sits down and looks at this and looks at the Oasis creator, his life, and also what are some potential backdoors or hints he might have been giving players to put in here. Wade regularly finds himself at a library within the Oasis that chronicled just about every aspect of creator James Halliday's life. And this is, in large, a place where you have a lot of the major turning points in the film. Wade is someone who is very much the exception of a close friend or so. Does a lot of things on his own within the Oasis. He doesn't believe in joining clans or guilds to try to pool resources or anything like that. He's very much sort of into his own just small circle of quest until he meets Artemis during the race. Everything changes from that point. As we dive further into Artemis's life, Artemis is played by Olivia Cooke. Wade really believes he's found someone sympathetic in that she's trying to crack the Easter egg clues for the game, really in similar ways that he is. In fact, he even goes as far beyond his infatuation. The fame he'd heard of from Artemis before, she's a known player, This is something that really quickly, and in my opinion, not very believably, progresses into love on his end. And I think that falls kind of flat on its face, honestly. It's something that felt way too rushed and way too quick. But even beyond that, I think there's some, again, what this film does well on is making statements, I think, within statements. I think most of the time, I just take scenes like this at face value and just move on. But there's more here. That is, Artemis gets really frustrated with the idea of Wade just being infatuated with the virtual idea of her, and really looking at him is just sort of deluded, that he really doesn't know her, her person, who she is. And that he's really just tricked himself into believing that he's actually in love. So I couldn't help but think of it. I mean, in the massive communities we have now for online gaming, I mean, especially when it comes down to, you know, MMOs and how relationships form, you hear this stuff all the time. There's people that, you know, actually meet and get married, you know, go on to have full-blown relationships. But there's plenty to say within that, as there is, I think, with the main vehicle that I pointed out a little earlier, too. And I want to take a second to delve into that, and that's with the IOI Corp. You know, this was the other huge analog here. I think it's pretty direct, and there is so many things that this corporation represents and points at to what we've actually seen happening. Now, I couldn't help but think of Star Wars Battlefront, the loot box issue, or how we have ads everywhere all the time, or how bot farms and gold farms. If anything, all of that is in a way commented upon here, you know, and the IOI Corp does all this. They see the race to find the Easter egg as just something they need to throw masses of resources at, masses of people at, to the point where they have organized a massive company solely for doing that. They just throw bodies and throw resources at it till they crack it. And this is something that's, you know, rampant today. It reminds me of the model of raw efficiency versus simple just gaming to enjoy, or just being in a social space to enjoy. The concept of bot and gold farmers, and if anything, RMT and loot boxes, things like that. The whole point of IOI Corp is they're trying to expand their influence to sell people ads and upsell, and then hopefully to bring things into a subscription model, which would break up the Oasis even more. So it's just this huge money-driven conglomerate they're trying to pull things towards. And you might say that's something bland on the outside, but the way industry clashes with gaming or with social spaces here is really interesting. And all of that is really culminated in the film's villain, who's pretty simple. Nolan Sorrento, he's played by Ben Mendelsohn. This is really a strong fist pump to simple villains being a good thing and not necessarily having to be really complex. And we've just come off films like Black Panther with Killmonger and others like that who have that kind of nuance to them, but not this guy. He's really just representative of someone who, or rather, a type of business model that can't get off the rails that it's used to and cannot think of any other way to function besides doing these things, besides trying to exploit others and ultimately make a profit. That's really just the bottom line business model at the end of the day, and it's simple. There's nothing else behind it besides that. Besides this commentary part that I think Spielberg frankly did really well on here in terms of setting this up, in terms of direction and how the characters dealt with it plot-wise, the world building itself left me scratching my head more than once here. There's a lot of things that just fall flat in their face that just aren't organized or explained in any way, and we just sort of move on from that. One of the biggest ones, biggest gripes for me was, you know, what are the rules of this world? We're never presented that book or that large Ten Commandments or whatever else, and from what I was looking, this is something much better defined, much more thoroughly defined in the actual book itself, go figure. But you just have crazy stuff being happening here. You know, the idea is if you zero out in this world, you can lose everything you've invested in your character. And this often is not just something you invested with an in-game currency. There are people actively remortgaging their homes, putting countless amounts of money and hours into this from the businesses, and they just sort of lose everything. I couldn't help being reminded of hardcore mode in Diablo. It took me back to the last time I played on ladder season in Diablo 3, doing a hardcore run with my group, and the idea of, losing your character and just losing everything. But this really came to a head in the club scene where Artemis ends up meeting up with Wade. And by the time they're getting hunted down and tracked down, you just have these members from the IOI Corps literally come crashing through the walls and just trying to gun them down, oblivious to whoever else is around. I mean, that's gotta suck. You sat here and collected all this stuff, and now you just get randomly mowed down because you happen to be in a PvP zone. You didn't know it was a PvP zone. That's that. That was kind of wild for me, and I really wish that there is more time. A little more time taken for things like that. Also, the not just reference, but I'm straight up gonna dock a point for the use of the Holy Hand Grenade of Antioch without counting down. Golden Sin. Any Monty Python fan probably wants to pull their hair out with that. It was a chuckle, but I don't see how you do that with that. Audio wise, the soundtrack itself, it wasn't really that memorable, to be honest. The sound effects were where they needed to be, especially with all the quips to retro gaming and to retro pop culture as was. So, at the end of the day, as far as a rating, out of number of coins I'm going to go with, I am going to give this one a 7.5 out of 10. That's 7.5 coins out of 10. Did not expect that coming into it, but this. Is it comes out as more of a winner in my opinion from the way that we have all of these different pieces of digital culture sort of archived and commented on here. This is well done, and there's really, in my opinion, a film sort of layered here within a layer or the surface layer of the action and the race scene and all the crazy war scenes and everything else. This movie doesn't stop there, and I think that's a good thing. So. Now my question is, do you find the same thing? Maybe not, maybe you do, but hey, would love to know. Drop a comment below if you could, or you can always send us an email, caissonmedia@gmail.com. But until next time, thank you everybody for tuning in. You have a good one. Hey people, thank you for tuning into this episode and taking a listen. If you like our content, if you like what you're listening to, there anything we go over, hey, please, we would not only love to hear more from you, but if great, if you could throw some support, you can subscribe right below. Also, you can toss us a line anytime. That's caissonmedia@gmail.com. Of course, you can tune in for our channel anytime for movie reviews, game reviews, a lot of random wacky stuff. Yet who knows what you'll hear. And of course, our episode each week where we're bringing the nerdiest things we can find, dig up, and maybe not find, maybe the stuff that just drops in our laps. But anyway, hey, thank you so much for tuning in. Thank you for listening. We hope to hear from you again later. Take care.